Good morning. Welcome to Marigold Baptist Church, bright and early on Sunday morning, Easter morning, the Resurrection Sunday. I'm so glad you're here as we worship together. Turn to hymn number 22. This is our call to worship. Bless His holy name. We'll sing the chorus, verse 1, 2, 3, and end with a chorus. Let's stand together as we sing. Thank you. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here this morning as we have gathered on this Resurrection Sunday to worship the risen Savior of the world, Jesus Christ. And if there are any visitors here, we want to give a special welcome to you guys. If this is your first time here, or if you've never filled out one of our cards, we invite you to fill out a visitor card located in the back of the sanctuary. Before we keep going, I just want to thank everyone for all of the food, the calls, the texts. You name it, y'all did it for us while we were sick. So we just want to thank you guys so much for the love and compassion and well wishes and everything that y'all sent us while we were not only out last Sunday, but these last about a week and a half since we've been fighting this virus. So thank you guys. Thank you so much for everything y'all have done for us. We love you guys. We appreciate you guys. So thank y'all so much again. Reminder, there is no evening service tonight. So after we leave this time of worship, we will go downstairs for Sunday school right after. And then there were no evening services tonight. So I want to remind everyone of that. And then also, I've been sending out a couple emails about a possible trip to Branson in October. If you are interested in that, please let me know by this Friday so I can put your name down. This would be a trip, a combined trip with Oak Grove Baptist and Hernando, where Ashton and I used to serve, to go see the play Queen Esther at the Sight and Sound Theater. If you've never been to or heard of Sight and Sound Theater, they are a Christian-based theater that put on only biblical plays. And it's not just a stage play, but there's people on the stage. It goes all the way around. There's people like on stages on the sides. They have it's very interactive, and it's an incredible theater. So if you would be interested in going the weekend of October 6th through the 8th, please let me know again by this Friday. And I have dates and prices and everything like that I can give you once we have a set list for those interested in going. But with that said, let's pray together and we will continue on with our time of worship. Heavenly Father, God, you are good. God, you are holy and you are perfect. Father, we thank you for everything you are. Most importantly, we thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ. God, we thank you for his death. We thank you for his burial. And God, we thank you for his resurrection. God, we thank you that he is not like any other religious leader or figure in the world who is still in the ground right now, God, but he is alive. He is alive indeed, Father, and we thank you so much for that. Father, we pray right now that as we continue on with this time of worship, God, that everything we say, everything we do this morning would be for your honor and for your glory alone. God, move us out of the way so that you can take the precedence that you deserve. Father, we thank you so much again for everything you've done for us. And we give this time of worship over to you now. God, have your way with it. May your will be done this morning. We say these things and we pray these things in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Grab a hymn book. Turn to hymn number 202. And then put your finger in 159. We're going to start out by singing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. And then we're going to sing a medley beginning on 159. So let's sing together. Verses. Thank you. my Savior. Vainly they seal the death. Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty cry for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives for with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose. Hallelujah, Christ arose. Death cannot keep his prey. Jesus, my Savior, he tore the bars away. Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph on his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with saints to reign. He arose, he arose. Hallelujah, Christ arose.
In 161, crown him with many crowns.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns, all music but his own. Awake, my soul, and sing of him who died for me. Matchless King through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of love. Behold his hands and side. Those wounds yet visible above in beauty glorified. Throughout eternity. Thank you. Grind the nails in my hands, laugh at me where you stand. Go ahead and say it isn't me. The day will come when you will see. And mock my name, my love for you is still the same. Go ahead and bury me, but very soon I will be free. Say I'm dead and gone, but you will see that you were wrong. Go ahead, try and hide the sun, but all will see.
Thank you, David. Aren't you glad this morning that not only is Jesus alive, but one day he is coming to take his children back home to heaven to be with him? Amen. I invite you this morning to turn in your Bibles with me to the book of Luke, chapter 24. And today we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 8. Luke 24, 1 through 8. While you're finding our passage this morning, I want us to think back a few years to the year 2016. Now, 2016 was an insane year for a lot of people. There was a crazy political battle going on in Washington. Gas, if you can remember this and imagine it, was $2.14 a gallon, which we could get back there. And the Golden State Warriors were making NBA history. After an 82-game regular season, the Warriors set a record with 73 wins and only 9 losses on the season, led by MVP Steph Curry. Now, they were overwhelming favorites to repeat as world champions. And they even made it again to the finals against LeBron James and the Cleveland Cavaliers. After four games, the Warriors held a 3-1 series lead, and everyone knew that at some point soon, Golden State was going to be holding up the Larry O'Brien World Championship Trophy again. But then something happened that people did not see coming. Golden State lost games 5 and 6. So going into game 7, the series was tied 3-3 going back to Oakland. And that night, the Cleveland Cavaliers did something that everyone else thought was absolutely impossible. It had never happened in the history of the NBA Finals. The Cavaliers came back and they won the NBA championship after having a 3-1 series deficit. This was arguably the greatest comeback in the history of the NBA. And it brought the Cavaliers their first ever world title. So why do I tell you that? Why am I going on and on about basketball? It's because today, church, we celebrate a much greater and an infinitely better, an eternally better comeback than that of a basketball team. You see, we have come here today to praise and worship God because Jesus Christ came back from the dead after 3 days, and he is alive today. I'm not sure y'all heard me. Jesus Christ is alive today. Amen? And in our text this morning, we only have one point, and it is that amazing, glorious point. In our passage, we see that Jesus Christ is alive. Beginning in verse 1, the physician Luke writes this. He says, "But on the first day of the week." Luke tells us that this story, this event, the greatest event in history, took place on a Sunday morning. And people often ask why we as Christians, why do we gather and worship on Sundays instead of on Saturdays or the Sabbath, like Scripture says in the Old Testament? Here we have our reason. We come together and praise and worship to God on the day of the week that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. We gather on the Lord's Day, Sunday. And Luke says that on this particular Sunday, they went to the tomb and took spices they had prepared. Now, later in verse 10, we see that a group of women were the first ones to go to where Jesus had been buried. There are three women here that we know by name: Mary Magdalene, a lady named Joanna, and a lady named Mary, who is referenced as the mother of James. But along with these three ladies, there are another group of women who we don't know the identities of. But we do know that they got up as early as they could at sunrise, and they went with spices to the tomb where Jesus had been buried. So they get to the tomb, and something absolutely amazing had happened. But they didn't know what that was. Continuing on in verses 2 and 3, here's what Luke writes. "And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus." In order to make sure that nobody would steal Jesus' body after he had died, a man named Joseph had this massive stone rolled in front of the entrance to this tomb, this cave where Jesus had been buried. Now, this stone weighed anywhere from 2,000 to 4,000 pounds. So this was not just a little boulder, and this would not have been easy to move. And not only that, but we are told in the other Gospels that they had sent two guards on either side of this stone to guard the body of Jesus so that his body would stay there. A lot of good that did. But when these ladies arrived at the tomb, first thing Sunday morning, they saw this massive stone had been rolled away. And there was, to them, a problem. Luke says that they went in and they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus, even though he had been there for 3 days dead. Jesus was no longer in that tomb. And in verse 4, Luke tells us how these women felt when they saw this. He says that they were perplexed. And one translation says they were utterly at a loss. These ladies were super confused about what they were seeing, and they didn't know what was going on. All they knew up to this point was Jesus had died, he had been buried, and now his body was nowhere to be found. As if that wasn't enough, they soon realized that they were not the only ones here at that tomb. Continuing in verse 4, Luke writes, "Behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. The Marys, Joanna, and the other ladies who were there looked up, and they saw two men standing there among them." And one translation says that their clothes gleamed like lightning. Their clothes visibly lit up the area where they had been standing. But these men were not men at all. In fact, they were angels sent to tell these ladies and the world through them the greatest news ever reported. And in verse 5, we see what the reaction to seeing these angels was. It was fear. Luke tells us they were frightened and they bowed their faces to the ground. Now again, at this point, they had no clue what was happening. Jesus' body wasn't in the tomb, and now there were these two angels who were there with them. And when they saw these angels, they were filled with fear. But not the normal kind of fear that we think of. They were not scared. The fear that they had was this reverent fear. They were in awe of the thing that they were witnessing. And so they did the first thing they knew to do. They put their faces in the ground in humility because they realized they were not worthy to witness what was happening. And after they did this, as these ladies were doing this, these angels gave them a truly life-changing question and a beautiful statement after that. Going further in verses 5 through 7, here is how the angels respond. "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he has risen. Remember how we told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered in the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise." They tell these ladies that they weren't going to find Jesus there because tombs were for dead people. And Jesus was not dead. Jesus was living. Jesus had told his disciples and his followers exactly what was going on. Happen. He told them that one day he was going to have to be delivered into the hands of sinful men, die a painfully cruel death, but also that he would not be in the tomb for very long. In fact, he would only be there for 3 days, and it happened exactly as Jesus said. Because when Jesus says something, when Jesus tells us something, it happens exactly as he says it will, because Jesus cannot lie. And in verse 8, Luke tells us, they remembered his words. When they heard the angels tell them what Jesus had said, they instantly remembered the words of Jesus, which I'm sure brought a huge amount of relief to them. Prior to his resurrection, Jesus was falsely and illegally put on trial in the middle of the night. He was mocked. He was beaten so badly that he was not recognizable as a person. He had nails the size of railroad spikes driven through his wrist and his ankles, and he died on a Roman cross, an instrument of torture that was reserved for the worst of the worst criminals. Even though Jesus had done absolutely nothing wrong. The Apostle Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 5 that Jesus, who knew no sin whatsoever in his life, became sin for our sake so that we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus, when he was on the cross, took on the full and complete wrath of God. He took on our sin so much that for the first and only time in history, God the Father could not even look at Jesus. And when he did that, he made it possible for us to be seen as righteous, as pure, as sinless in the eyes of God. Now, I don't mean to put Jesus back in the grave, because like we've said, praise God, Jesus is alive today. But I tell you that for two reasons. One, so that we can remember what Jesus went through on Good Friday. And I pray we never forget it or take it for granted. But two, so that we remember, unlike every other religious leader or figure in history, Jesus Christ is not in the ground anymore. Jesus Christ is not dead. Jesus Christ is alive and well today. He came back to life after 3 days, and when he did that, church, he defeated death, he defeated sin, he defeated hell, he defeated the grave, he defeated Satan once and for all, forever. The resurrection of Jesus Christ makes all the difference in our lives. We do not serve a dead Savior this morning or ever. Jesus Christ not only came back to life that day, but again, he is alive, sitting at the right hand of God, making intercession for us. Jesus is praying to God the Father for us on our behalf. Jesus never had to die again, and he never will again. Jesus Christ is the only one who can take our sin and make us right before God. If Jesus never came to this earth at Christmas, if he never died on a cross on Good Friday, if he never rose again on Resurrection Sunday, we would be in big, big trouble. Because if those things never happened, we would die and would go to hell as punishment for our sin because of the things that we have done wrong in our lives. But because of God's infinite, matchless love for us, he sent Jesus to earth to die so that we could live just like Jesus lives today. Freedom from our sin and eternal life in heaven with God is only possible through a relationship with Jesus Christ. Salvation only comes by the grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life. It is a gift, church. It is an amazing, matchless gift from God. And he wants every single person alive to accept it, to receive his gift. In just a second, we're going to have a time of response, of invitation. If you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, if you've never fully trusted in him as the Lord and the Savior of your life, I could not think of a better day, a better time than Resurrection Sunday for that to happen. If you have never turned away from your sin in repentance and turned to Jesus Christ and everything that he has to offer, that can happen right here and right now. Like I said, in just a second, we're going to have a time of response. And if that's you this morning, I urge you, I beg you, come to faith in Jesus today before it is too late. Come serve. Come give your life to the risen Savior of the world today. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for who you are. God, we thank you for this day. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the resurrection of Jesus Christ today. Father, we thank you that his resurrection made all the difference in our lives, in our eternity, Father. We thank you for that gift. Father, if there is anyone here today who does not know you, Father, I pray that today would be the day of their salvation. Father, I pray they would turn from their sin. I pray they would put their faith in you as Lord and Savior of their life. Father, during this time of invitation, of response, we give it over to you. Father, if there's anyone here who needs to do business with you today, who needs to give their life to you, get right with you, Father, we ask, we pray that you would convict that person. Father, we thank you again for this day, your day, Father, the Lord's day, where we come together and we worship the risen Savior of the world. We thank you for that. And Father, may we never forget what Jesus did for us on Good Friday or the fact that he is alive, and he is alive indeed. Father, we say these things and we pray these things in accordance with your will and in your holy name. Amen.
Our hymn of invitation is number 324, Have You Been to Calvary? Let's stand together as we sing.
Have you been to the cross where the Lord Jesus suffered? Have you been to Calvary? Have you been to the place of redemption for sinners? Have you been
now to Calvary. Amen. Well, thank you for being here this morning. Don't forget, we were going to...
Just a quick announcement. Since we're not having a service tonight, as long as I'm busy meeting tonight, we're going to move to next Sunday and a deacon meeting next Sunday.
All right. Yeah, deacons meeting and business meeting pushed back to next Sunday night. Don't forget, we will be heading into our time of Sunday school right after the service. So we invite everyone to stay and join us for our time of worship in Sunday school. But with that said, let's pray together and we will head downstairs. David, would you pray us out, please, brother?
Lord, we are humbled by today and what it means to each one of us. Lord, you gave your Son on the cross to save us, to give us eternal life. Lord, we want to thank you for that. We can't imagine the agony that you went through. And of course, we know the agony that Jesus went through, but he knew he was following your will in his life. Lord, be with us as we leave this place today. May our light, life be a shining light for you in this community. May we always look to you for guidance in all the decisions in life. Lord, give us your peace and your mercy and your forgiveness for all those times that we failed. Thank you for being here with us today. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.